to emerge and or persist.
At Rutgers University, the researchers who invented the crime mapping platform called Risk Terrain Modeling, or RTM, bristle at the term predictive policing.
We don't want to predict, we want to prevent. I worked as a police officer a long time ago. In the early 2000s, police collected data for as long as police have existed. Now, there's a greater recognition that data can have value, but it's not just about the data, it's about how you analyze it, how you use those results. There's only two data sets that risk terrain modeling uses. These data sets are local, current information about crime incidents within a given area, and information about environmental features that exist in that landscape, such as bars, fast food restaurants, convenience stores, schools, parks, alleyways.
The algorithm is basically the relationship between these environmental features and the outcome data, which in this case is crime. The algorithm provides you with a map of the distribution of the risk values.
This is the highest risk area on this commercial corridor on Bloomfield Avenue.
But the algorithm isn't intended for use just by police. Criminologist Alejandro Jimenez Santana leads the Newark Public Safety Collaborative, a collection of 40 community organizations. They use RTM as a diagnostic tool to understand not just where crime may happen next, but why.
Through RTM, we identify this commercial corridor on Bluefield Avenue, which is where we are right now, as a risky area for auto theft due to car idling. So why is this space particularly problematic when it comes to auto theft? One is because we're in the commercial corridors where there's high density of people who go to the beauty salon or to go to a restaurant, Uber delivery and Uber Eats delivery people who come to grab orders that also and leave their cars running, create the conditions for this crime to be concentrated in this particular area.
What the data showed us was there was a tremendous rise in auto vehicle thefts. But we convinced the police department to take a more social service approach.
Community organizers convinced police not to ticket idling cars and let organizers create an effective public awareness poster campaign instead.
And we put it out to the NARC students to submit in this flyer campaign and have their artwork on the actual flyer.
As you can see, this is the commercial corridor on Bloomfield Avenue. The site score shows a 6, which means that we are the highest risk of auto theft in this particular location. And as I move closer to the end of the commercial corridor, the site risk score is coming down.
This is the first time in Newark that police data for crime occurrences have been shared widely with community members.
The kind of data we share is incident-related data, sort of time, location, that sort of information. We don't discuss any private arrest information. We're trying to avoid a crime.
In 2019, Kaplan and Kennedy formed a startup at Rutgers to meet the rising demand for their technology. Despite the many possible applications for RTM, from tracking public health issues to understanding vehicle crashes, law enforcement continues to be its principal application.
Like any other technology, risk terrain modeling can be used for the public good when people use it wisely.
We as academics and scientists, we actually need to be critical because it could be the best model in the world. It can be very good predictions, but how you use those predictions matters in some ways even more.
The police department had revised the SSL numerous times since its inception.
In 2019, Chicago's Inspector General contracted the RAND Corporation to evaluate the strategic subject list, the predictive policing platform that incorporated Papachristos' research on social networks.
I never wanted to go down this path of who was the person that was the potential suspect. And that problem is not necessarily with the statistical model, it's the fact that someone took victim and made him an offender. You've criminalized someone who's at risk that you should be prioritizing saving their life.
It turned out that some 400,000 people were included on the SSL. Of those, 77% were Black or Hispanic.